Welcome to another Doctor to Health Mastery series, where we aim to enthuse, educate and empower you towards becoming a better patient and being a master of your own health. Remember, nothing said here is a recipe for the management of your condition, and you should always seek medical advice from your physician, your doctor, your GP about your specific symptoms so you can get a tailored management plan. What I really want to talk to you about today is glaucoma and driving. Glaucoma is a leading cause of irreversible blindness around the world, affecting 66 million people globally, with 12 million people being registered blind as a result of glaucoma. And this is probably an underestimate. In the United Kingdom, 2% of the population are affected by glaucoma. Importantly, glaucoma presents with no symptoms in its early stages, and in fact it can be quite advanced with over 90% damage to your nerve or vision, your optic nerve, before a patient may develop symptoms. It often starts by causing damage to your peripheral vision, so that's the vision around you, okay, preserving your tunnel vision. And you can imagine, if you have a significant amount of your peripheral vision damage, it can make driving, looking around and being aware of your surrounding a lot more difficult, and therefore not only risky for you, but risky for other people and other members of the public also. Now, many patients with glaucoma can still drive as long as they meet the minimum requirements of the DVLA. In the United Kingdom, there are specific requirements when it comes to, you know, driving and any particular medical condition. And I'd like to take you through some of the key requirements with regards to glaucoma. And as I talk you through this video, you will hear me mention Group 1 drivers and Group 2 drivers. So Group 1 drivers are ordinary drivers. So this is, you know, driving your own personal vehicle. Group 2 drivers are drivers who drive heavy goods vehicles, buses, or passenger vehicles. You know, that may be minibuses or taxis. So this is the difference, and you can imagine there is a greater requirement, a higher standard usually that Group 2 drivers have to meet when it comes to the DVLA, because, you know, they're either the vehicles that they drive are a lot more risky if things go wrong, or they're carrying passengers, and hence, you know, their responsibility whilst driving isn't just to them, but it is also to those passengers that they're carrying. Now, for Group 1 drivers then, if only one eye is affected by glaucoma, you can still drive as long as the unaffected eye meets the minimum requirements according to the DVLA. However, if both eyes are affected by glaucoma, it is a requirement that you inform the DVLA. It doesn't necessarily mean that you cannot drive, but they will give you further guidance. For Group 2 drivers, so remember, that's heavy goods vehicles, those who drive buses or passenger vehicles, you must notify the DVLA, even if only one eye is affected by glaucoma. So first of all, I'd like to talk you through the visual acuity requirement. So visual acuity is how well you can see, basically. For Group 1 drivers, you should be able to see a standard UK number plate from at least 20 metres away. Now, there's something called a Snellen chart that we use to measure your visual acuity, and this you may remember having done this at the optician, you know, pointing out various letters on a mirrored glass that get increasingly smaller in size. Now, the minimum visual acuity should be 6 over 12 with both eyes open, or 6 over 12 in one eye if you only have one functioning eye. Now, for Group 2 drivers, the standard is stricter. The visual acuity in your best eye should be at least 6 over 7.5, and in your weaker eye, it should not be worse than 660, so 6 over 60. Now, with any of these visual acuity requirements, you can actually meet them using glasses. However, there's a requirement by the DVLA that the correction required should not be greater than 8 diopters. But again, this is not something for you to remember. I mention them really just as the principle for you to understand when you approach your doctor or your optometrist, optician with regards to your visual acuity in relation to driving. Now, as well as your visual acuity, so how good your vision is, there is also a visual field requirement. So how widely around you can you see? And this is usually done with you focusing on a fixed point in front of you, and you're then exposed to dots or moving fingers in various parts around your visual field. So your general practitioner can assess your visual field to have a very sort of crude estimate of whether or not you've got a significant visual field defect. But for the purpose of the DVLA, you actually need to have a more detailed visual field test, which is usually done by an ophthalmologist or an optometrist stroke optician. Now, as I mentioned, your visual field is tested with you focusing at a point in front of you, and you're then exposed to various dots around your visual field that you are required to identify. And failure to identify these dots can identify areas of your visual field that may be defective. Now, for group one drivers, the DVLA expects you to have a visual field that spans at least 120 degrees from the fixed point ahead of you. And it should, as a minimum, span at least 50 degrees to the weaker side. Okay, so at least 120 degrees visual field span, that should be normal, and a minimum of 50 degrees to the weaker side. Now, there are really additional detailed requirements when it comes to your visual field and the DVLA's standard for driving. And it's based on whether you're able to identify or not identify clusters of dots, and whether those dots encroach on your central visual field. Now, let's talk about additional health management tips. If you have glaucoma with significantly impaired vision, then you may in the United Kingdom be eligible to a 7 benefit. So speak to your GP, doctor, optician or ophthalmologist about this, so that you can have support that is available out there for you. There are also organizations like the RNIB, Royal National Institute for the Blind, which provides a tremendous amount of support for people with a visual impairment. Thank you very much for getting to the end of this video. I hope you've really enjoyed it, and I hope one or two things at least stood out for you. And if they did, mention it in the comments, or send us a message, on where you'd want us to emphasize on, other topics you'd like us to talk about in the future. I'll be more than happy to review them and take them on board, because the whole aim of all of this is to give you quality information that will help you be more of an expert in managing your health, so that you can have a higher level conversation with your physician. And look, it is only beneficial to us, because at the end of the day, the more informed you are, the better an outcome we can achieve when we decide on whatever is the appropriate management plan for you. Remember, if you genuinely liked this video, please give it a like and subscribe to our channel, so that you'll be the first to be informed when new videos come out, and share it with your friends and loved ones. I think there's nothing more selfish than keeping good information to yourself. Share it with your loved ones, let them learn and benefit from it as well. That is why I'm sharing this with all of you, so that you can be informed and you can learn and benefit from this.